Of the Bharatanatyam repertoire. The original torchbearers of this art form were the practitioners of Sadr. The Sadr repertoire had dance pieces that were addressed to the deity of the temple to which the Devadasi was attached, where she had been symbolically wedded to the deity. So all the songs and dances would reflect the shades of Shringara, especially love and separation, jealousy and yearning. Many of the old pieces are still performed today. The content of many of these songs reflect the life situations of that era. Maybe as they had a certain spontaneity and reality in their depiction, the portrayal of Shringaram by the original practitioners is said to be special, different, and altogether a different level of experience for the spectator. But today we are not in that era. Today, the cool sandal-scented air of the past has become putrid and stale. The shaded groves that allowed lovers to tryst and cavort are now vanishing. The cool ice surrounding Shiva has yielded to naked ice peaks of the Himalayas. There is no vana left in Vrindavan. Can Shringara, as we understand it in Bharatanatyam, have any continuing relevance today? Taking us down memory lane, but also raising relevant questions on how meaningful presentation of Shringaram in Bharatanatyam really is the celebrated artist and star performer, dancer and choreographer, Srimati Geeta Chandran, who is celebrated as a composite artist, known for her understanding of Bharatanatyam and deep expertise in Carnatic music. Her work in television, video, film, theatre, choreography, dance education, dance activism, dance issue journalism. Founder president of Natya Vriksha, Srimati Geeta Chandran is also artistic director of the Natya Vriksha Dance Company and has been decorated with numerous awards. Welcome, Srimati Geeta.
As Lakshmi Akka said, there was a Balamma in front of her when she was dancing. There are many, many Balammas today in the audience and many, many friends. And I'd particularly like to acknowledge Srimati Hema Rajagopalan, who's been a student of my teacher, Swarna Saraswati Amma, whose work I'm trying to recreate today a little bit because I was pushed by Srinidhi to do that. She said, you must show us a reference point and tell us something about how you learned the dance form. So I have tried to recreate because journeys go on and life goes on. I stopped learning with her in 1976. So it's a long way back. I've tried to recreate the hands and tried to be as true to what she taught me. Very simple. There was as Lakshmi Akka rightly put it, I think we didn't clutter our minds with too much. It was just very plain dancing. So it might seem very simplistic for many people, but I just thought that, and Shringara for me is not really an emotion restricted to a padam or a particular piece. It's something that is all-encompassing. It's something that is an attitude, a feeling. So I feel it's reflected right from the Shabdam on to all the pieces. So I'd like to share this little journey. As I said, dancers will see it as a very simplistic thing, but the hands and the connections and the music are all, I think, something that I value greatly. We used to always start with the Tirupugar. So I begin with the Tirupugar. ശിവനാർമനം കുളിര ഉപദേശ മന്ത്രമിര് ചെവിമീതിലും പുകശേ ഗിരുനാഥ ശിവനാർമനം കുളിര ഉപദേശ മന്ത്രമിര് ചെവിമീതിലും പകശേ ഗുരുനാഥ ശിവകാമസുന്ദരിതൻ വരബാലവന്ദനിന ശയലേ വിരുമ്പിയുളം നിനയ മൽ
ശിവനാർമനം കുളിരം ഉപദേശമന്ത്രമിന ചെവിമീതിലും പകശേ ഗുരുനാഥ
ചീരലു മെല്ലെ ചേ കൊണി തരുവുനേ
Ooh. Bhanu Padma Vale Dura
Let's keep going. lights, please? Could I have the house lights, please? It's always very difficult to talk after performing, but this was my little tribute to my teacher. And thank you. And it was hard to stop oneself from doing what one has learned from the other teachers. Subsequently, one had to curtail and just do justice to what she taught. And there was a beauty and simplicity, as I said. And I think Abhinaya was all about exploring. There was a lot of Adbhuta in going into Shringara. And it was not about eyeballs, how many eyeballs you can catch, but it was about, you know, getting immersed and involved. And we would always be said that this is not good enough and you have to work harder and you have to kind of move on. I wrote many, many scripts for this particular event, but I think I would like to speak extempore because a lot of things have been said. And as I said, Shringara is really not one piece, but it's an approach of the entire body stance, of the entire attitude over a period of time that the dancer comes into. So it cannot be really said, this is a Shringara piece, and hence Shringara begins and ends here, and this is it. So I seriously feel that it is an attitude, and one has to kind of understand, I would say Shringara is beauty. I would extend it to not just love, but beauty. Beauty in every aspect of what you do in dance. Right from the namaskar that you saw, I'd like to go in a little into the pieces that I did, because today the namaskar is more like this, but they always did this in whichever approach that they did. So I think there was a difference in the use of the body and the use of the shoulders, use of the hands, was all, again, stems very deep from music, because music is really the essence. And when I was working on it, what I saw was economy of gesture, because the same hand would convey many things because the music nuancing would be different. So even if you use this four times, it would each time be different. They didn't look for more hastas to say what they had to say. It was the same hasta that was used in very many different nuanced ways. And we enjoyed working. I must thank my musicians who worked very hard and tried to, because some of the pieces, even the basic metta has changed. So I had to really remember what I had learned. But thankfully, I think what you learn when you are very young, you do remember. So I was able to come out with those, and they worked very hard. So economy of gesture. And the second thing, I think, what I see the difference between today and what was, is that there was no need to create. The existing pieces were so beautiful and they were so fulfilling, and everybody felt so happy doing them and rediscovering them and revisiting them again and again, that they found new meaning and new value to the existing pieces. This whole rush for creating new things has, I think, left us a little not being able to stay in these pieces and enjoy them, because I think those people really stayed in these pieces and enjoyed them. Today we do one piece once and then move on to the next, because the next piece has to be something new that we look for. So I think the strength, and that's when I feel very bad. In music, they sing the same pieces over and over again and we love it. But in dance, we do one varnam, two seasons, and people say, oh, she knows only that much. So I think there is that little thing of being able to re-engage with a piece again and again. Now I come to the most crucial thing, is training. Because I think Shringara can be taught, but it needs a lot of staying power and long years of learning. Because today what's happening is I crave to see a piece choreographed by the great gurus. I don't see it. Everybody is doing their own piece. Even when they teach, I think they are teaching what they are writing and composing. Now, how will the child know what the tradition is? Unless we teach the tradition as it is. And unless at least five varnams we know of the great gurus, how they are handed down to us, how will you know how the technique of approaching a varnam, how the technique of approaching a padam, what is it? Because I don't see any difference in abhinaya in the varnam or in the padam. It looks very much the same. And hence, dance is boring. But dance is not boring. If you see a difference in approach in the abhinaya in the varnam, there is a different, distinct approach of abhinaya in the padam. But today, I think the sameness of approach has made dance boring. So in a varnam, for example, the structure is what is the most important thing. And there is no room for telling stories. Because you have to do a jati for 5 minutes, that does not give you, because you're tired, you need to tell a story. So I think that balance of how much of what is crucial in a varnam. So I think the great masters just did about 6 to 8 hands, kai, that they would say for a varnam, and move on. The varnam was not the place to, you know, kind of go into a lot of other things because it has a structure. Moga means it has that modulation which is there. So you cannot freak out with that. You have to be within that and create. So I think the hands were really the variety of hastas were what were used in the varnam because the same line, how can you say it many times differently with the face and with the hands? It's not about telling a story. That's what my understanding is. Please correct me if I'm wrong. It's the padam that you explored. You really, you had the liberty of starting from the Anupallavi. You had the liberty of going into one line. You had liberty of taking half a line and exploring it. So all that, I think, came in the padam. And then, of course, we've added many more layers by expanding the format. But I still feel the Swarajati, the Varnam, and the Padams are really the mainstay when we talk about Shringara, because this is where the source is. This is where, this is the khazana, what we say in Hindi. And unless you learn all this, I don't think you have the skills to create contemporary work. Because contemporary work can be done only if you have a very sound core understanding of Bharatanatyam. Otherwise, it really smacks of something somewhere missing. That's so I think the silences, the way we stand, the way we walk, the way we look, I think all that is extremely important. So I think the training, it was very sad. I went to a university in North India, I don't want to name it, and they were doing their bachelor's and master's program. And when I asked them how many padams they know, they said they don't know a padam. So this is the level of teaching, learning, institutional, non-institutional, whatever it is. So if that's the thing, and tomorrow somebody out of that university is creating something without learning a single padam, I think how, you know, how dangerous it is, what is being unleashed. So I guess that's what I'm not touching on the contemporary aspect. There's a lot of people who are talking because I did want to talk about who is dancing, for whom are we dancing, and why are we dancing? I think the three main questions in today is... Okay. I'm very scared of Srinidhi. She's very particular about time. So I want to wind up before she says stop. So, today we are very educated. We have access. I don't have to really depend on my musician or my great scholar friends for lyrics. You can just Google and you get the lyric. So it's very easy. I saw Radha Badri with a cell phone with the Shruti. So it's become easy, very easy to access information. So we are actually inundated with a lot of information. How we actually sift that through and use it to our benefit is something that we need to work out. For whom are we dancing is the saddest point today. The audience is completely clueless. So I guess that's the main pressure as to why we are forced to create things many times which we don't want to. Sometimes pressure from presenters, sometimes pressure from impresarios who've taken on the job of giving you a subject which you need not be interested in, but you've got to do it for your presence. So I think there are lots of things that people compromise on today because the audience is so ill-informed. So I think that is a question that we all collectively have to see, what can we do about it? I think taking dance and music to schools is the only option. You have to bring it into the curriculum. There is no other way. That we've already lost 4 or 5 generations, and I don't think we have any more time to lose. This has to be brought into the curriculum, and at least I pledge my entire life for dance education in schools, because I think that's where the story begins, and that's where one has to give oneself. And the another crucial question is why we dance. So why we dance is always comes with the with learning something, because you have stakes. Today we learn only pieces that we can perform. This is a very sad situation. We need to learn for the sake of learning, because unless your skill basket is huge, I don't think you can pick and choose. You cannot, even in an arangetram, I have seen people teach pieces only that can be performed. It's not really a piece to know the grammar of the style or to understand the depth of what dance is all about. So if we are only going to teach and learn pieces that are sellable and that can be performed, then we'll be only doing 10-minute pieces dedicated to Shiva and five-minute jatis. So that's all we would be doing. So I think we need to think about, go beyond teaching and learning what is not performable, but for the sake of understanding the grammar, we need to. I conclude with a small piece, which is my own work. I have traveled a lot after my teacher, and this is a work from my senior fellowship in Haveli Sangeet. And the lyrics are different, the music is different, and I hope the philosophy and the ethos is the same.
Murali dhun
Thank you, Srimati Geeta Chandran. I'd like to now invite the audience to come up with few questions, if any. But I have a question to Geeta Ji. Oh, sorry. No, I was just wondering, when you spoke about the need to, you know, the Abhinaya part of current day performances, I find now that, you know, more than what the dancer wants to perform, I think the somehow, you know, we feel that whether it is the reviewers or the audience, they seem to applaud, I mean, at least the audiences, they applaud more of these, you know, the jatis have to be longer and longer and longer and more complex. I even saw somebody do a jati for a, you know, for the Jatiswaram, the first jati went on for about, you know, 15 minutes. So the thing is, do we really have a choice? I mean, we all, I'm sure everybody wants to do the traditional and all that, but the craze seems to be for the contemporary and for the rhythmic.
It's true. I have no answers for this. It's the audience that needs to, you know, be educated and say the soul of the dance lies in the Abhinaya and not really in the, because that is all predetermined.
One has to understand the manodharma happens only in the abhinaya. And if you're killing that aspect of Bharatanatyam, then I think you're making it into more of a very, very choreographed, structured dance form from a very fluid and a very, very lyrical. And so I seriously feel more than what worries me is a long jati. What is in that jati? You know, I don't mind if it's a very, very wonderful arithmetic exercise for 5 minutes. But most of the time, it is just rambling. You know, so I just feel, what are you doing at the end of the day? That's also equally important. Because most of the jatis are not by the gurus. They are by mridangis. Sorry to say, Ganesh, you're here. But many times the mridangis has a certain approach and the dancer is clueless. So anji jati kurtudupa. This is the request. So anji jati comes in whatever format he decides. And since he knows very well the dancer has no clue, he also is not willing to dialogue. You see, earlier the dancers could say that yanaki ipdi dhaan vaasikano ipdi vaasike koodadhu, because mridangist also knew that the dancer knew. So today the situation is very different. So I think that's part of the reason that we don't know. It's just the length of the jati and not what you're saying in the jati. The first sollu is never continued in the tirmanam. You have 5 solus in 1 jati. So I think that bothers me more than the length of the jati. So length of the jati, yes, it dazzles. I see the dancer once, but there is no repeat value. I don't want to see the dancer again. But why did we go and see Balamma again and again, or we see Lakshmi Akka again and again? I want her to do the Muttavadura. Not Muttavadura. Neematale. I want her to do it again. I want to see it again. So I think there is no repeat value if you keep on doing the same thing. And it's and what's more saddening is that a certain mannerism is being copied because that is sellable. And I don't think when the original is there, we don't want to see a clone.
Audience is very silent today. No questions, no comments.
Rajika, New York.
Can you hear
it's
me?
It's not working, Rajika.
One of the things I feel that we don't always take into account, when you did this Haveli Sangeet just now, as somebody who understands every nuance of it, and I'm not even Rajasthani, just simply because I understand the language. So part of the reason, I think, that people don't want to listen to Pada is because if it's in a language you don't understand, you don't relate to the heart of it. And that's why I appreciate that you're doing other kinds of music and dancing it.
That's accepted, because I think we're not pathbreakers in that, because M.S. Amma sang Meera so beautifully many, 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 many years back. So I think that is still the source for many things and which inspires all of us. So we are not doing pathbreaking work in taking North Indian poetry. But as I agree, language is a huge issue. But I'm not talking about what you pick up, but how you do it. The question is how you do it. See, because it's a different verse or a different language, how much do you move out of your vocabulary? I have not moved out of my vocabulary at all. So I think that's the thing. If the core understanding is there, whatever you do, it's going to smack of just that classicism. I think that's where the matter ends and begins.
One question.
I'm sorry.
Geeta Chandran.
Yes.
As you are a Delhiite,
yes,
and music really doesn't know any boundaries. Have you tried to express abhinaya to a ghazal, for instance? Even a short ghazal where it's full of shringara, for instance. You know?
I have, but I decided not to do it after that.
Why?
Because I think it's, you know, the cultural context is also there. Now you say Saki, again and again, if you say Saki, Saki, somehow with the Bharatanatyam then I have to change the attire. I have to change a lot of things to suit that kind of court scenario or that kind of a different kind of a mindset. So I think it is possible. It's not at all difficult. But it's just the cultural context is too jarring for me personally. I wouldn't mind anybody else doing it. I'd love to watch it. But personally, I might not want to do it.
Namaskar. I just have a question.
Yes, please.
Could you just tell us what are the challenges you face when you teach Sringaram to youngsters?
Lots, because they don't know how to feel shy. Because that's not part of the deal today. Why? Why should I feel shy? So I think the cultural context has changed so much. We're talking to young, very empowered. So you're going to disempower them a little, you know? You have to disempower them and bring them into another space, because as they are born and brought up in various metros, it is very difficult to sometimes for them to relate to a very, very coy Naika or a Naika who is Abhisarika, who's braving the weather. He says, what is there? You know, one message and it should be done. So I guess the cultural context is so different. So yes, we need to spend a lot of time and contextualize it. And I was to go into the more contemporary thing, because when you talk about the moon and the beauty of the moon, I was talking about Sharad Purnima, and in Delhi we are wearing masks, we don't see the moon. So the reality is very, very different today. Yamuna is like a nala. So you talk about the beauty of Yamuna, and so it's all in the imagination, and thank God we have this space. We just fly, we just do what we want here, and thank God for that, because we can imagine, we can make you imagine. So I guess this space has become, as Ashish and Akka said, that it's become more important than ever before. Because there's so much of negativity and stress all around, that this is the only space where we can just fly.
I remember Birju Maharaj once taking a class, and he said, I can try as much as I want to. I can't convey the idea of lajja to these youngsters, because they just don't experience it in their own lives. I mean, their lifestyle is so different. How do I tell them what lajja is? So he says, jab bhi main purani thubri wagara leta hu, to uski jo khushbu hai wo khatam ho jati hai. He says, the fragrance of that composition disappears, because unless you know what lajja is, unless you felt it and you have some idea of what it is, you will not be able to show it in the dance.
Yeah. Teaching is very, very hard today. And as I said, even getting ready, for example, for us, going to a dance class would mean wearing a bindi, wearing a bangle, wearing a half sari, and getting dressed and coming into a frame to go into the dance class. But today they are just rushing, changing their clothes quickly, coming into the class. So I think the frame, they are into many, many frames. So one has to bring them into a particular space before we can actually begin to teach a particular piece. So it's that much more difficult for the teacher. And we've heard a lot from Kalanidhi Mami, and she used to really tell us, what is this? So, you know, that kind of thing. And she used to teach us pieces which were out of your comfort zone. For example, she'd say, you are not the gossipy type. Adnala nee choodare panna. You know? She said, I know you might not ever perform it, but nee adu kattuko. Because that doesn't come naturally to you. So that's the technique of training, you know, where you learn because you have to learn. You have to go through that whole grind.
Namaskaram. I have a question.
Yes, please.
I don't belong from this state. So when I see the performances in North Side, there we generally don't understand if they are performing in any Tamil language or Telugu language. Sometimes when they perform in Sanskrit, we can understand it. But I feel that, of course, literature plays a very important role in this. And when we see over here, you were talking about traditions. So most of the traditional padams, javalis or varnams, they are in Tamil, Telugu. And plus in North, we won't understand the beauty of the literature. And we won't understand. And plus the actions which we show, the hasta abhinaya which we show, it is very much traditional. So, and sometimes people don't understand it in northern sides. So, what is your view?
You are a very rare breed who understands Sanskrit but doesn't understand other languages. People don't understand Sanskrit also. So, I think that is... So, understand, not understand. When we perform to a foreign audience, they understand nothing. But they have tears in their eyes. I think dance and music is beyond language... or beyond all these things. I think you have to have a clean, clear mind. You have to feel from here. You can't appreciate art from here. It's here.
We'll take this as the last question. Okay. Because we have
Picking up from the last two questions, Akka, I'm just trying to understand. I mean, we are talking about the necessity of cultural context for appreciation or for learning, but also for appreciation. But again, when we talk about, say, a non-trained or a non-West, I mean, let's talk about Western audience, not non-trained, because Indians, in some way or the other, we have some cultural context to everything. So when a Nayika is sitting and waiting and she's decking herself up endlessly and, for example, grinding the sandal paste, all these things are very much outside the context of a non-Indian audience. But is that probably why, I'm just trying to pick your brain here, is that probably why of late or over the years since we've moved to other global spaces that the dancer gets forefronted than the performance itself? I mean, because that being another context, I just wanted to ask you. Because the beauty of what's being done, the overall beauty...
I feel there is no one way of looking at it because everybody takes back what they want to. You know, nobody can be clubbed as a group because everybody comes from a different frame of reference. And even that's true of an Indian audience or an audience outside because they take back some are limited to just the costume and they say, oh, you looked beautiful. The second one would say that, you know, the music and the dance, they came together beautifully. Or a third one would say, how do you use head to toe every single part of your body? So well trained it is, it's so sophisticated. And that engaged me. So I think there are different levels of engagement with the artist. So one can't really club, this is what an Indian audience is like. This is what an... And I don't see in India that, you know, in a Chennai audience, maybe they understand the music and the language a little, but still I think the Chennai audience also is equally clueless of many of the nuances that we are looking for to understand. So I think the audience all around is the same, you know. So it's not as though Madras is fantastic for music, but for dance, I still feel that, you know, ella nanandama ananda kalthila and the potundrunde adu mattu ni maathidu. This is the kind of comment when you've, you know, indulged in a new varnam, you've worked through the season and come. Nobody is going to talk to you about anda kai nanandama anda anga oru paathe anda oru idea. I have not heard. So I just feel audiences across are, I think, the levels are very different. So I just feel there's no one thing that the foreign audience take back this, the Indian audience takes back. It's not like that. I think everybody takes back different things. But I think we have to learn to go beyond this word-to-word understanding and meaning. We have to find a way of engaging with the dancer through the heart, and that I think is possible, and that's what we have to, for that the heart has to be a little pure. This is the Delhi gang. Well, on Nattuvangam, we have Dr. Vasudevan Iyengar, K. Venkateshwaran vocal, Shri Ganesh Mridangam, now Chennai, but we think he's still Delhi, and Raghavendra Prasad, a young,
He's just out of class 12 and I've got 98% marks and he wanted to take up only the violin.
I must confess that I have hardly, I think I don't have any knowledge about Kathakali. To me, it represents an extremely intriguing, stylized classical art form where entire stories, personalities, and emotions are conveyed through highly elaborate costuming and makeup and veshams for different characters and so on. But it is important to note that Kathakali is well known for intense abhinaya and portrayal of different moods, including Shringaram, not just for the elaborate, spectacular costuming and makeup, but it is also known for its intense emotive appeal. Many Kathakali plays begin with a love scene of the hero and heroine of the play. Both the performers and the audience give a lot of importance to these Shringara-oriented scenes. And they are set in a slow pace so that the performers get enough scope to present subtle nuances of Shringaram. To elucidate how Shringaram and its moods are conveyed in Kathakali, I am honored and delighted to welcome Shri Sadanam Balakrishnan, one of our most renowned exponents of Kathakali. Shri Sadanam Balakrishnan commenced his study of Kathakali under Guru Kondivetal Narayana Nair, Asan, under the patronage of the late Brahmashri Kurumattur Narayana Nambudripad, who later supported his intensive 8 years of training at Gandhi Seva Sadhanam Kathakali Academy in Palakkad district. I am delighted to welcome Shri Sadanam Balakrishnan, who is going to talk to us about the moods of Shringaram in Kathakali.
Thank you.